I'm John Dyer V.
And I'm Laura Dickinson Turner.
With NewsWrap, a summary of some of the news in or affecting LGBTQ communities around the world for the 3 weeks ending January 4th, 2020. The United Methodist Church's LGBTQ inclusion supporters and its traditionalist conservative wing are about to split. Officials of the worldwide 80 million member Christian denomination announced the amicable separation on January 3rd. Ordinations of queer clergy and same-gender weddings have roiled the third largest denomination in the U.S. for several years. The divide would occur later this year. Officials said that the split between pro- and anti-LGBTQ wings would affect the entire denomination around the world. The church claims more than 13 million members in the U.S., and some 67 million members in other countries. A substantial number of congregations are in Africa. Under the planned Protocol of Reconciliation and Grace Through Separation, the Queer Inclusive Branch would adopt official policies affirming queer clergy and lesbian and gay marriage ceremonies. $25 million would be allocated over 4 years for the traditionalist group to establish itself. The plan still needs to be approved at the church's next general conference, scheduled for May 2020 in Minneapolis, Minnesota. New York Conference Bishop Thomas Bickerton was on the planning committee. He said that the protocol provides a pathway that acknowledges our differences, respects everyone in the process, and graciously allows us to continue to live out the mission of making disciples of Jesus Christ.
In his seemingly obsessive goal to overturn all things Obama, U.S. President Donald Trump's Interior Department has removed sexual orientation from its ethics guidelines about workplace discrimination. The Obama administration's 2009 guidelines had called for equal opportunities for all Americans, regardless of race, color, religion, gender, sexual orientation, age, or disability. Trump's revision means that gender now most likely refers only to being male or female. Gender identity is also noticeably absent from the new version of the agency's 14 Principles of Ethical Behavior. Internal documents obtained by the nonprofit Friends of the Earth through the Freedom of Information Act in November have sexual orientation crossed out in red. Just who did the editing remains a mystery. Interior Department spokeswoman Carol Danko called the revised guidelines just a simplification of terms. She told the Huffington Post that a number of courts have ruled that federal civil rights laws already protect LGBTQ people. Danko did not explain why the Trump administration has argued against that interpretation in 3 queer employment rights cases now before the U.S. Supreme Court.
Brazil's president, Jair Bolsonaro, made sure that journalists and LGBTQ people had an uncomfortable holiday season, and a Christmas Eve firebombing provided the homophobic exclamation point. During a press conference at the end of December, Bolsonaro was complaining about how he's being treated by the media. He is sometimes called the Donald Trump of the tropics, after all. In response to one reporter's question about corruption allegations against his lawmaker son Flavio, the president snapped, "Your face looks an awful lot like a homosexual's." Bolsonaro is infamous for his racist, sexist, and anti-queer remarks, including his oft-quoted claim that he would rather have a dead son than a gay son. Another one of his actual sons recently tweeted an image of himself with an assault weapon next to his kill, an image of the already famous drag queen son of Argentina's new president. Bolsonaro later issued a lame apology for his press conference outburst that many of his critics lampooned. Jean Willis is a former Brazilian congressman who had to flee the country after escalating death threats. He tweeted, "An awfully homosexual face, with pride."
Anti-queer violence was already common in Brazil, but it has mushroomed since Bolsonaro's election. That mushroom exploded on Christmas Eve when several Molotov cocktails were hurled into the Rio de Janeiro offices of the comedy group behind a Netflix movie parody. In Porta dos Fundos's The First Temptation of Christ, Jesus brings home his boyfriend, Orlando, to meet the Holy Family. Happily, a security guard on duty December 24th was able to extinguish the flames. There were no injuries. A defiant tweet by the production company said the attacks made them more united, stronger, more inspired, and confident that the country will survive this storm of hatred and love will prevail along with freedom of speech.
Pakistan's Prime Minister Imran Khan began the new year declaring that his government is taking responsibility for the nation's transgender community. A new medical identification card makes them eligible for free government-paid healthcare services, including transition-related care. Trans activists have been increasingly vocal about routine denial of medical treatment, or, at best, harassment and ridicule from hospital staff and patients. Dr. Zafur Mirza is a special health services aide to the Prime Minister. He said the government plans to cure that problem by establishing separate hospital wards for transgender people. Pakistan legally recognized transgender people in 2012 with a third gender option on government forms and other official documents. However, trans activists say that only about 2,500 trans people are currently registered. Human Rights Ministry trans rights consultant Aisha Mughal said that the first step is to spread the word. It is just the beginning.
Croatian activists are calling the Zagreb Administrative Court's December 19th ruling for a same-gender couple's right to foster children a historic decision. The Rainbow Family Association has a lawsuit pending in Croatia's constitutional court challenging a law passed late last year that banned same-gender couples from foster parenting. The advocacy group hailed the ruling as the first time a Croatian court has upheld international case law and rulings of the European Court of Human Rights. That court has ruled that queer couples must be treated the same as heterosexual couples under the law. The Ministry of Demography, Family and Social Policy denied the application of Ivo Sigota and Mladen Kozik to be foster parents in late 2017. That led to the couple's lawsuit. The court gave the ministry 60 days to reverse that action and issue an unbiased decision. Sigota told local reporters that the couple had received a positive review after interviews and psychological assessments, but were eventually told that government policy prevented their approval.
A three-judge panel of Belize's Court of Appeal has unanimously upheld a 2016 Supreme Court ruling that overturned the ban on consensual adult gay sex. That ruling called the ban a denial of the constitutional right to dignity, privacy, equality before the law, freedom of expression, and protection from discrimination on the basis of sex. Activists applauded the December 30th conclusion of a nearly 10-year battle and a final appeal by both the Caribbean nation's government and the Roman Catholic Church. One of the veteran soldiers in that battle, Caleb Orozco, celebrated a renewal of hope in the substance of the Chief Justice's decision in 2016, which still stands.
U.S. Ambassador to Zambia, Daniel Foote, has been officially recalled. Foote had issued a statement in early December saying he was horrified by the sentencing of a consenting adult gay couple to 15 years in prison. The South Central African country's homophobic president, Edgar Lungu, said he would refuse to work with Foote and demanded that the veteran diplomat be removed. In what has become the rule rather than the exception in the Trump years, an administration source told Bloomberg News that the State Department has no immediate plans to replace Foote.
We're happy to report that a gay Saudi Arabian journalist in Australian immigration detention has finally been released after more than 2 months. He and his partner are known by the pseudonyms Sultan and Nassar for the protection of the couple and family members back home. Nassar was released on December 13th, but Sultan's release was delayed for 4 days due to what authorities called a clerical error. The couple fled Saudi Arabia after their worst fears about being outed seemed to be materializing. Same-gender sex can be punished by execution in the Islamic nation. Both men have now been granted what are called bridging visas that allow them to live in the country while their asylum requests are being processed.
Finally, an 11-year-old Cedar Hills, Utah fifth grader defended his gay dads during their mid-December TV appearance on CBS This Morning. Ahead of the U.S. Thanksgiving holiday, a substitute teacher asked Daniel Van Amstel's class to say what they were each thankful for. Daniel said he was looking forward to his adoption by his dads. The teacher responded that homosexuality is a sin and that two men living together is wrong. She even asked the child if he thought he would become gay. Three of Daniel's classmates complained to the principal. The substitute teacher was fired on the spot and escorted off the school premises, still reportedly spewing homophobia. While one of the dads hoped for dialogue, Daniel would have none of it.
I would love to have lunch with her.
Mm-mm.
And sit down.
Why not?
I do not like her. If I ever saw her again, I'd probably have a heart attack.
Daniel made a simple case for the beauty of rainbow families.
It doesn't matter what family you have. It just matters if you love them or not. And yes, I do love them.
That's NewsWrap, global queer news with attitude for the 3 weeks ending January 4th, 2020. Follow the news in your area and around the world. An informed community is a strong community.
NewsWrap is written by Greg Gordon, edited by Lucia Chappell, produced by Brian DeShazer, recorded at the studios of KPFK Los Angeles, and brought to you by you.
Help keep us in ears around the world at thiswayout.org, where you can also read the text of this newscast and much more.
And you can listen to NewsWrap each week by subscribing to our This Way Out radio YouTube channel. For This Way Out, I'm Laura Dickinson Turner.
And I'm John Dyer V.